Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Red Ice by William C. Dietz, narrated by Ryan Burke. Chapter 1. South China Sea, aboard the Zumwalt-class destroyer, USS Stacy Heath. It was a bright, sunny day, the sky was achingly blue, and fluffy white clouds were reflected in the waters of the South China Sea. There were no whitecaps, just an orderly procession of gentle swells, each following the rest south. So as the USS Stacy Heath's inverted bow sliced through the water, Captain Mary Franklin felt nothing other than a slight vibration. Franklin was 5'8" and slim. She had short, rusty red hair, most of which was covered by a navy ball cap. A spray of freckles crossed the bridge of her nose prior to spilling down onto her cheeks. Franklin had graduated from Annapolis 18 years earlier, and been in the Navy ever since. To port and starboard, 24 nearly identical Chinese fishing trawlers could be seen. The rusty boats were about 75 feet long, had open bows and two-story superstructures. Some of the vessels were uncomfortably close to the Heath despite repeated warnings. Were spy ships hiding among them, sent to track the warship's movements? Yes, of course. Such was the way of things, and had been for a long time. As for the real fishing boats, they were an international source of concern due to their well-documented tendency to hoover up fish at a rate that the world's oceans couldn't sustain. But fishing was only a small part of it. There were indications that substantial reserves of oil and gas were waiting to be plundered beneath the seabed. And that, many analysts believed, was the real reason for Chinese expansionism. The Heath's mission was to challenge the Chinese government's claims of sovereignty in the entire South China Sea, as part of the ongoing effort to prevent China from annexing the entire area. The immediate source of concern was the smudge of land visible up ahead. It was called Mischief Reef. And, having spent hours studying satellite photos of the circular coral formation, Franklin had a mental image of it. The passageway to the inner lagoon had been enlarged to a width of 900 feet, so that Chinese dredgers could pass through. Dredgers the Chinese had been using to pump white sand up onto the existing land, enough sand to support buildings, and Franklin knew that similar reclamation efforts were underway elsewhere. According to Chinese government, all of the projects were peaceful in nature, like the airstrips that could be used for search and rescue missions, a pretense that no one believed, least of all the men and women who ran the Pentagon, and wanted to reaffirm America's right to send ships through international waters. Any fucking time we want to, as one admiral put it. Franklin approved of the mission, but like her peers, she understood how uncertain the current political situation was, both internationally and at home. Part of that stemmed from the fact that the President of the United States was notoriously unpredictable. On Monday, he might be in favor of lifting sanctions on Russia. By Tuesday, he could oppose it. And the president's posture regarding China was no different. According to Hayden's supporters, it was all part of a clever strategy to keep opponents off balance. Those on the other side of the aisle suggested that the lack of clarity resulted from a short attention span, and a tendency to follow whatever advice he'd heard during the last 10 minutes, including that provided by Fox News. Franklin's thoughts were interrupted by the shrill sound of a whistle, followed by an announcement over the ship's PA system. Man overboard! Man overboard! Starboard side! This is not a drill! This is not a drill! Franklin felt something like cold water enter her bloodstream as the OOD officer of the deck, Lieutenant Commander Lambert, began to issue orders. Some idiot had fallen into the drink, and given the ship's circumstances, that could be disastrous. What if the Chinese managed to get their hands on him? Shit, shit, shit! They would use the sailor for propaganda purposes at the very least, and might take the opportunity to harass the ship with flybys or other forms of intimidation. After reducing power and checking to make sure the man in the water was well clear of the destroyer's screws, Lambert ordered, "Slow astern," followed by, "Stand by." "Launch a boat," Franklin ordered. "Put an officer on board and arm the crew. Who's the floater? Do we know?"
"Seaman Larry Wilson, ma'am,"
the navigator replied.
What the hell was he doing?
We don't know, ma'am.
Is he okay?
As far as we can tell, he's wearing a life jacket and swimming toward the ship. Sound general quarters. This might turn into a shit show. Aye, aye, ma'am. Franklin heard a shrill whistle, followed by a klaxon, and the announcement every sailor was familiar with. General quarters, general quarters. All hands, man your battle stations. That was little more than a formality in this case, since all the ship's sections were closed up and on high alert. Tell Lieutenant Chow to get on the horn and warn the trawlers off, Franklin ordered. They are not, I repeat, not to approach Wilson. I'm going aft. The Heath's mission center had been compared to something from Star Trek. Huge flat panel screens were mounted against the starboard bulkhead. Rows of computer stations faced the monitors, and the 20 people stationed in front of them were trained to handle all of the ship's communications, weapons, and engineering functions. TAO, Tactical Action Officer Chow, was waiting for Franklin. She was short and intense. I can't raise any of the trawlers, ma'am, but they're gabbing with each other. Keep trying, Franklin ordered. Maybe we can herd them like cattle. The Heath was equipped with two Northrop Grumman MQ-8 Fire Scout unmanned helicopters, which could be launched and controlled from the mission center. She leaned in between the UAV pilots. Are your birds ready to lift?
Yes, ma'am,
Lisa Rafferty replied. What kind of loadout are they carrying?
Hellfire missiles, Derek Foster answered. Two each.
Excellent. Put him in between the trawlers and Wilson. See if you can push the fishing boats away from him. The tech said, aye, aye, in unison, and went to work. Franklin's next stop was the comm section. The lead information systems tech was a woman named Sims. They're bound to be at least one spy ship out there, Franklin said. They'll start squawking soon. ID them if you can, and pass the information to the weapons officer. We'll kill them if we have to.
Sims had short hair, dark eyes, and mocha-colored skin.
Aye, aye, Captain. We'll find him.
Franklin heard her name and pressed the transmit button on the radio. This is the captain.
Lambert here, the XO said. One of the trawlers is trying to cut us off from Wilson. A second boat is moving in to pick him up.
Franklin swore silently. So much for her plan to scare the trawler captains. They were calling her bluff. Franklin found herself in a no-win situation. She could destroy both trawlers in seconds. But if she did, China would accuse the United States of attacking peaceful fishermen as they attempted to rescue an American sailor. Not the sort of story the president or the chairman of the Joint Chiefs would want to see on the front page of the New York Times. And if Franklin allowed the Chinese to grab Wilson, the bastards would parade him in front of cameras in Beijing as proof that the U.S. had violated Chinese waters, or some equally ridiculous bullshit like that. And Franklin had seconds in which to decide. Lieutenant Chow was watching her.
Fire a warning shot in front of the first boat, Franklin ordered, and prepare to do the same with the second. Execute.
A rating named Rig had control of the ship's 6-inch guns. Franklin went over to stand beside him.
Don't hit the bastards, she cautioned. Just scare the shit out of them.
Video and targeting data was visible on the screen in front of Rig. He used a joystick to swivel a deck gun around. Franklin watched the crosshairs settle on a patch of open water. A key clicked, and there was a muted thump as the gun fired. A column of white water shot up in front of the incoming boat. It veered away.
Good work, Franklin said. What's the other target up to?
It's still coming our way, Chow replied.
Fire another warning shot, Franklin instructed.
Then, as Rig tapped a key, Franklin spoke into her radio.
Lambert, is the boat in the water yet?
Yes, ma'am,
but it's going to take at least 10 minutes to reach Wilson and take him aboard.
Tell them to hurry,
Franklin said, and immediately came to regret it. The boat crew knew they were supposed to hurry, and unnecessary orders were self-indulgent.
Belay the last order, Franklin added. They know what to do.
One of the trawlers is talking nonstop to what might be a shore station,
Sims interjected,
and the transmissions are encrypted.
A fishing vessel carrying military-grade comm gear. That served to confirm Franklin's suspicions.
Put in a call to the GW, USS George Washington, and tell them we need air cover ASAP.
The carrier was just over the horizon and sure to have at least two planes in the air. Franklin could have called on the fighters earlier, but had been hoping to keep the rescue low-key. That was impossible now, and if the military trawler was calling for help, the situation was going to get worse, a lot worse.
Yes, ma'am,
Sims replied and went to work.
They're pulling Wilson out of the water, Lambert announced over the radio. We'll have him back aboard in 15.
15 minutes, Franklin thought to herself.
That was like an eternity.
We have four, repeat four, bogeys inbound from the north,
Operations Specialist Corey Moore announced. He was seated in front of a Spy 3 radar screen and could monitor everything for miles around.
I have confirmation from the GW Super FUD, Moore added. The ETA for the bogeys is 5 minutes.
Franklin knew that Super FUD was a nickname for the Navy's E-2 Hawkeye airborne early warning aircraft. 5 minutes wasn't a whole lot of flight time, and a good indication that the Chinese planes had taken off from the base on Hainan Island.
They probably have orders to buzz us, Franklin told Chow. But you never know.
We're ready, Chow assured her. The boards are green, and the ESSM system is hot.
ESSM stood for the Evolved Sea Sparrow Missile System, also known as the RIM 162. The Sea Sparrows were quad-packed in Mark 41 vertical launchers and capable of destroying all of the incoming planes. That offered some comfort, but not much. The Heath was virtually dead in the water, and the very definition of a sitting duck.
I have the GW on the horn, Sims announced. The Admiral is waiting for you on a secure video link.
Franklin was surprised to say the least.
You must be shitting me.
No, ma'am. And they say it's urgent.
I'll take it in the booth.
The booth was a small enclosure where it was possible to have a private conversation. Franklin had no idea what Admiral Geary would say, and didn't want the bridge crew to listen in. She stepped into the cubicle and closed the door. Geary was visible on the screen. He had a buzz cut, hollow cheeks, and an uncharacteristically dour expression.
I'm sorry, Mary, he said, but I don't have enough time to grease this up for you. Don't fire on the Chinese regardless of the provocation. That's straight from the Commander-in-Chief. Hayden is trying to reach Premier Lau. He says the Premier is a good guy, and the two of them can do a deal.
Franklin could hardly believe her ears. Yes, she understood the stakes involved, but what about peace through strength and all the rest of the campaign bullshit? Now, based on Geary's comments, it sounded as though the president was going to cave. Franklin struggled to maintain her composure.
Even if they fire on us?
Even then, Geary said grimly. And I can't send the planes you requested, not until I get the green light from Washington. The National Security Advisor fears that the planes might be seen as provocative.
Provocative? Franklin demanded. Who cares? What about my crew? And my ship?
I'm sorry, Geary said miserably. Those are my orders.
Franklin heard a muted roar.
Chinese fighters are buzzing the ship, Admiral. I have to go.
And with that, Franklin broke the connection. Another roar was heard as she left the booth.
They're looping us, Chow said, as Franklin reappeared. But that's all so far.
Franklin spoke into her radio.
Lambert, is Wilson aboard?
Yes, Captain.
Change course and head for the GW. They can't send planes, but we can go to them.
They can't send planes? Lambert demanded.
Why not?
Because the president said so. Full speed ahead. Take evasive action.
Lambert liked that.
Yes, ma'am.
Franklin could feel the additional RPMs through the soles of her shoes as Lambert demanded more speed. The destroyer was capable of 20 knots and could clear the area quickly. The deck started to slant as the Heath made a turn to the east. Franklin felt better. The Chinese had driven the American destroyer off, taped it, and could feed the video to the world. But the Heath and her crew were safe.
Here comes another one, Chow said.
Franklin looked up just in time to see the laser-guided bomb drop free of the J-8 fighter plane's belly and head straight for the Heath. Franklin opened her mouth to shout a warning, but it was too late. The 1,000-pound bomb hit the destroyer's superstructure and exploded. The jolt threw Franklin and Chow to the deck. Fortunately, the Heath's armor was thick enough to withstand the blow. The Chinese had been planning to attack all along. The initial flybys were intended to put the Americans at ease.
Engage those planes, Franklin ordered as she scrambled back to her feet. Kill them!
The response was instinctual and made without regard to Admiral Geary's orders.
Fuck Geary and the president, Franklin thought. There's no way in hell that the Heath will go down without a fight.
The ship shook as a second bomb struck the superstructure. Damage control parties rushed to respond, and Rafferty spoke up.
The fire scouts are still airborne, ma'am. Can we kill the trawlers? The ones that called the planes in?
Smoke 'em, Franklin ordered. And recover the scouts if you can.
The ship's ESSM system was firing on the Chinese planes. 6 missiles, 4 kills, Chow reported calmly.
More bogeys on screen, Moore announced. 6 targets inbound from the north.
Franklin swore. It was clear at that point. The attack on the Heath was more than a misunderstanding. The Chinese were all in. They were going to war, and sinking the Heath would give them a Pearl Harbor-like victory right off the top. The planes weren't likely to make bomb runs this time. They would use standoff weapons instead. Franklin gave the order.
Shoot them down,
and heard Chow pass it on.
Missiles fired and tracking, Attek said. I have an additional target, Moore said. It's inbound from the north ETA 2 minutes. My guess is a cruise missile.
Franklin knew the Chinese had a subsonic cruise missile called the CJ-10. It had a range of more than 900 miles and was equipped with a variety of guidance systems and could deliver a 1,000-pound payload. Odds were that it had been launched from the mainland.
Knock it down if you can, Franklin ordered. 3 kills, Chow put in,
but that wasn't enough.
Missiles incoming, Moore reported.
Then they hit. It was like taking 2 blows from a gigantic hammer. One of the weapons blew a hole in the port side of the superstructure. A second struck only yards away from the first point of impact and sprayed the mission center with shards of shrapnel. Chow died instantly. Her blood sprayed across Moore, who was dumped out of his chair. By some miracle, Franklin was still on her feet. She helped the tech up off the deck. His hand was slick with blood. A petty officer was screaming for his mother, and another sailor kept calling for a corpsman over and over.
Systems down, Duty Chief Atkins said thickly. Rerouting, rebooting. We're back up.
Franklin's head was spinning. There was so much to think about, and so little time in which to do so. The good news was that the Heath was resilient, and her self-healing systems could reroute critical functions, but the destroyer was taking casualties, lots of them, and the crew was small. Critics said too small. How long before Franklin ran out of bodies? Chief Atkins stepped in to replace Chow. He was standing in a pool of the dead officer's blood.
We nailed the missile, ma'am. There are 2 planes on the screen. They're well out of range and circling.
They're waiting, Franklin thought. For what? The answer came quickly.
1-1 high-speed surface targets, Moore announced. Inbound from the north.
Rib boats, Franklin decided. Based at Mischief Reef? Yes, to keep nosy neighbors away. Fortunately, we have an app for that.
Stand by on the MK-46 gun system, Franklin ordered. Engage the intruders the moment they come into range. Aye, aye. Chief Atkins replied.
The 30-millimeter chain guns could fire 200 rounds per minute and were fed by 400-round magazines via dual feeds. Their effective range was 2,200 yards. Sims had been wounded. A bloody bandage was wrapped around her head.
The GW is on the horn, ma'am. We have permission to engage. Fighters are inbound.
Franklin couldn't help but laugh. It had a shrill sound.
Tell them to fuck themselves.
Franklin allowed herself a moment to think. She had disobeyed a direct order. Her career was over. The only thing that mattered was saving her crew and ship.
Targets are in range, Atkins intoned. Firing!
The chain guns produced a sustained bang, bang, bang sound as the automatic tracking system sought the rib boats out and destroyed them. Franklin eyed her watch. Less than 20 minutes had elapsed since Wilson had been brought aboard. It didn't seem possible.
I have radio contact with a flight of 4 Super Hornets, Sims announced. J-8s are running for home, Moore added.
That's it, Franklin said. I think we're in the clear.
Lambert, do you read me?
5x5.
I need damage assessments pronto.
Aye, aye.
Franklin took a moment to look around. The mission center looked like a slaughterhouse. Foster was curled up on the deck, clutching his gut and whimpering. Franklin wanted to cry. And later, once Franklin was by herself, she would. Meanwhile, a rivulet of blood ran out of the black-rimmed hole in the destroyer's side and trailed back along her port flank. The South China Sea was waiting to receive it. Aboard the Chinese submarine, Great Wall 009, the South China Sea. The Yuan-class sub was 254 feet long, about 27 feet wide, and cruising 200 feet under the surface of the South China Sea. The dimly lit control room was located directly below the conning tower. Indicator lights glowed red, green, and amber. The air was heavy with a miasma of diesel fuel, cooking odors, perspiration, and the fishy smell of amine, a chemical used to remove carbon monoxide from the air. That was the atmosphere that Lieutenant Commander Chang Jing and his crew had to breathe as they waited to die. Like his peers, Chang was something of an expert on American warships and their capabilities. That included Zumwalt-class destroyers like the Heath. So Chang knew that the ship that he'd been ordered to sink was equipped with the latest detection gear and vertically launched anti-submarine rockets. According to Chinese intelligence agencies, as well as Wikipedia.com, the ASROC anti-sub missiles carried by the Heath were designed to deliver Mark 54 torpedoes to a pre-calculated point, where they would home in on the 009 and destroy her. That's when Chang would die. As for the 37 men under Chang's command, the only thing they knew was that the 009 had been sent to find and shadow an American ship, the kind of mission they'd carried out on previous occasions. Why trouble them with the truth? 9 was a lucky number, but their submarine was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
It's the sort of mission that a nuclear attack boat should carry out, Chang thought. But they're out in deeper water playing with themselves.
Tama tanam. Fuck them.
The bitterness stemmed from the fact that Chang had applied to the School for Nuclear Submarine Commanders and been denied twice. That didn't bode well for his career.
But, Chang told himself, test scores aren't everything. I will prove myself by dying well.
Chang's ruminations were interrupted by sonar operator Ku.
I have a contact, sir!
Ku was employing passive rather than active sonar to avoid detection. Chang felt his heartbeat start to increase.
What have you got?
2 screws, sir. Turning at high RPMs. The acoustic signature is similar to that of a Los Angeles-class submarine, but it isn't a sub, so there's a high likelihood that we have our target.
Stealth, Chang thought. Zumwalt-class destroyers are supposed to be stealthy, just like submarines.
Well done, Ku. Take her up to periscope depth, Lieutenant Shan. I want to confirm the ship's identity.
Rather than blow the sub's tanks, Shan chose to drive the boat to the surface using a combination of control planes and propulsion. Once the 009 arrived at the correct depth, the diving officer began to raise the periscope, even as he used the sub's low-pressure blower to eject water from the ballast tanks. Then Shan stood to one side so that his commanding officer could look through the scope. What Chang saw was too good to be true. There was no mistaking the Heath's katana-like bow and streamlined appearance. 2 overlapping black-edged holes could be seen on the ship's port side. Gray smoke streamed back along the destroyer's flanks. The damage was consistent with the urgent message Chang had received 20 minutes earlier. Judging from the size of the destroyer's bow wave and what Ku told him, the warship was operating at flank speed. In the distance, Chang could see the glint of sunlight reflecting off metal as a fighter circled the enemy ship. The Americans had control of the air then, so why hadn't the Heath attacked and killed him?
Ku,
Chang said, without turning away from the periscope.
Are they pinging us? No, sir!
Thanks to our air independent propulsion system, the Americans can't hear us, Chang concluded. Or all of their sonar operators are dead, and some of their systems are offline. Maybe I'm going to survive after all.
This is not a drill, Chang announced. Prepare to fire torpedoes 1 through 6, set to acoustic homing. Confirm. 1 through 6 acoustic, the weapons officer replied. Confirmed. All weapons ready to fire. Fire 1, fire 2, fire 3, fire 4, fire 5, and fire 6, Chang ordered. Torpedoes away,
the weapons officer replied stoically. What was the man thinking? That Chang was insane? It didn't matter. An order was an order. Under normal circumstances, Chang would have given orders to dive deep to escape a counterattack by the target's escorts or allied aircraft. But the Heath didn't have any surface escorts to rely on. And while the planes circling above the destroyer could be carrying standoff anti-sub weapons, they were unaware of the 009's presence. Chang pulled a quick 360 but didn't see any threats.
All torpedoes running straight and true,
the weapons officer reported. All Chang could do was watch and wait. 5 long seconds passed. Finally, after what seemed like an hour, the first torpedo hit the destroyer just aft of her bow. The second, third, fourth, and fifth weapons were equally spaced along the length of the ship's hull, the sixth missed by a few yards. Wherever a torpedo struck, there was a bright flash, followed by an upswelling of spray and a puff of smoke. There was no sound, not for Chang, but the explosions would be quite loud on the Heath, and Chang couldn't help but smile. The destroyer's speed dropped from 20 knots to nothing in less than a minute. The Heath wallowed and began to sink as water surged in through a dozen holes. Chang saw two international orange life rafts appear next to the stern. With no additional drama, the Heath slipped under the surface and disappeared from sight. Huge bubbles rose to the surface, followed by scattering debris and a series of radiating waves. The Great Wall 009 was victorious. A dozen American sailors were rescued by Chinese fishing trawlers, handed over to the Navy, and paraded in front of cameras in Beijing. Captain Mary Franklin was not among them, but by some miracle, Seaman Larry Wilson was. Chapter 2. Forward Operating Base Hope, Coast Province, Afghanistan. A Black Hawk helicopter clattered overhead as Air Force Major Dan Falco followed Broadway south to the command bunker. Forward Operating Base FOB Hope was a sprawling affair that consisted of perfectly aligned tents, a Navy field hospital, a civilian-run chow hall, an Army motor pool, and the roughly 400 men and women who were stationed there. With the exception of the CIA's spooks, all of the personnel were part of the Joint Special Operations Command, or a support group. World War III was about a month old, and like everyone else, Falco was acquainted with both versions of how the conflict began. According to the account put out by President Hayden, he'd been on the phone with Chinese Premier Lau, cutting a deal to avoid bloodshed, when a renegade naval officer named Franklin attacked a fleet of civilian fishing boats. But that story was an out-and-out lie, according to Admiral Frank Geary, who, after flying home from the Pacific, went on CNN to explain what actually happened, and that was a badly bungled attempt by the president to negotiate a deal with the Heath being fired upon. Then, in response to the shame he felt, Geary blew his brains out on camera. A tragedy which, according to the president's loyalists, proved that Geary was batshit crazy. Falco was doing his best to ignore the politics of it. His job was to control and direct ground attack aircraft, although very few missions were underway, as Hope's personnel worked day and night to pack everything up. The need for that was obvious. Pakistan was only 30 miles away, and after the so-called Heath incident, the PAKs had decided to side with China. Why? Because the Pakistanis hated the Indians, that's why. After sinking the Heath, the Chinese invaded India to gain control of the Buddhist monastery in Tawang Arunachal. That's where the next Dalai Lama was expected to incarnate, an event that could trigger an insurrection and threaten China's grip on Tibet. All three countries had nuclear weapons. In hopes of scoring a quick victory over India, Pakistan made use of tactical nukes. India responded in kind. And as 800 tanks clashed near Wazirabad, thousands died. While the major powers focused their attentions elsewhere, the Kurds took the opportunity to create a new state called Kurdistan, which laid claim to large chunks of Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Iran. The resulting chaos provided remnants of ISIS and Al-Qaeda with an opportunity to slaughter thousands of disbelievers in order to create a caliphate. Then, in a breakthrough piece of diplomacy, the Israelis chose to form an alliance with Saudi Arabia, even as the oil-rich country attacked Iran. Meanwhile, in an effort to restore the Soviet Empire to its former glory, the Russians invaded Ukraine. NATO had no choice but to respond, and it wasn't long before the remaining conflict spilled over into Belarus, Poland, and Romania. That raised the threat of an all-out nuclear war. So, since Afghanistan shared a border with Pakistan, American troops needed to get out while the getting was good. Afghanistan would have to fend for itself, and if history was any guide, Pakistan and China would be well advised to leave the country alone. That's why Falco expected base commander and Army Colonel Lloyd Campo to hand him a pack everything up shit detail. As Falco approached the JOC, Joint Operational Center, he saw that a battlefield fashionista was guarding the ramp that slanted down into the underground bunker. Like his peers, the operator was armed with an exotic rifle, was decorated with tats, and wore a beard. Salutes get old when people see each other every day. So the men nodded to each other. A corporal left the JOC as Falco entered. It was like a madhouse down below as soldiers, sailors, and airmen sorted documents and packed them into boxes. A senior airman spotted Falco and came over. The colonel is in the briefing room, sir. Do you need anything?
No, thank you, Falco replied. I'm good.
The briefing room was an island of serenity in a sea of chaos. Campo was there, along with an Afghan national, and they were poring over a map as Falco entered.
There you are, Campo said.
This is Mr. Jawan Mohammadi. He'll be your guide. Jawan, this is Major Falco. He's a JTAC, Joint Terminal Attack Controller, and a damned good one, too. If Hashemi shows up, Major Falco will send him straight to Jahannam. Hell.
Falco felt his pulse quicken. Campo was going to hand him a mission rather than a chore. He stepped forward to shake hands. Mohammadi was clean-shaven and dressed in the usual outfit of vest, long shirt, and baggy trousers. As their hands made contact, Falco noticed that the Afghan's palm was soft rather than calloused, and his English was exceptionally good. An educated man, then.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Major, Mohammadi said. With your help, we will rid ourselves of the goat turd named Noor Mohammad Hashemi.
Falco looked at Campo. The army officer had a white sidewall haircut, blue eyes, and a lean body. He smiled.
That's right, Falco. We're going to give the people of Coast Province a going-away present. The Taliban sent Hashemi to the area, and he uses murder, kidnappings, and gang rapes to keep people in line. That alone is enough reason to cancel his ticket. But, according to our intel people, he's the bastard who conceived and orchestrated the Valentine's Day attack.
Falco had been inside the wire the day that a farmer drove his truck into the fence and blew himself up. A squad of Haji had been hiding in a stream bed nearby. They rushed through the hole and opened fire. 5 soldiers were killed during the ensuing gun battle.
That works for me, sir, Falco said. One question, though. Could we use a predator drone?
Hashemi likes to surround himself with civilians, Campo replied, so we haven't had a good opportunity to use a drone. But a wedding is going to be held in the village of Embal 2 days from now, and, assuming that Jawan's sources are correct, Hashemi will attend. Both he and his bodyguards are legitimate targets, but we'll need more than a pred to wipe them out. The trick is to grease the bastard without killing any civilians.
He murdered my sister, Mohammadi added tightly, for going to school.
I'm sorry, Falco said, and he was. And like Campo, Falco wanted to kill the man behind the attack on Fob Hope. That would be an excellent way to end his tour in Afghanistan. The next 30 minutes were spent discussing the particulars of the mission. Under normal circumstances, Falco would have been a part of a 2-, 3-, or 4-man team, but Campo was sending him to Embal alone.
This is a unique situation, Campo explained. The mission will require a person with eyes on to ID the target, and given how exposed the op, observational post, is, a larger group will be too conspicuous. A quick reaction force will be on standby if the shit hits the fan.
Falco nodded.
Yes, sir. One more thing, Campo added. I'm delegating on-scene commander authority to you. You'll have the best vantage point, and I trust you to make the correct call.
So Falco and Mohammadi were going in by themselves, and rather than enter the operational area during the day, they were going to infill during the hours of darkness. After discussing the weather forecast, enemy activity, and close air support, Falco returned to his tent. His first task was to select the right comm equipment and to check it over. His choices included a tablet computer, plus an AN/PRC-117G radio, with a PRC-152 as backup. Other than the comm gear, Falco didn't plan to bring much, just his weapons, ammo, 1 MRE, a jet boil stove, and a hydration pack. After prepping for the mission, there was only one more thing to do, and that was to take a nap, because Falco was slated to depart at 2000 hours. Sleeping could be difficult with helos roaring overhead, vehicles growling past, and people shouting orders. So earplugs were helpful. But it was Falco's capacity to sleep anywhere and at any time that came through for him. Falco's alarm went off at 1830 hours.
He rolled out of bed, took a hot shower, and got dressed. The routine never varied. The ritual began with checking to make sure his TAC vest was properly loaded, with a Ruger silent SR-22 caliber pistol, extra magazines for his carbine, and the all-important first aid kit. Then it was time to load his pockets. Power bars were important, as were packets of instant coffee. Then, with the pack on his back and his M4 carbine in hand, Falco left for the mess tent. It was open 24/7, and Falco ordered his favorite pre-op meal, which consisted of a double cheeseburger and chili fries. Various people said hello, but left it at that, since they could tell that Falco was outbound. Some people were gregarious prior to departing on a mission, but many weren't. So it was SOP to give operators like Falco plenty of space. After finishing his meal, Falco stopped by operations to make sure that the weather forecast and the overall strategic mission were the same as they had been earlier in the day. Then he left for the mortar pool where Mahamadi was waiting. If the Afghan was nervous, Falco couldn't detect any signs of it. Mahamadi was dressed in the same outfit Falco had seen earlier, plus a nondescript pack and a night vision headset. The device was new to Mahamadi, and he was fiddling with it.
"You look green, Major, but I can see you quite clearly."
"Good," Falco said. "Let's mount up." The Taliban didn't like to fight at night, but they could. So the Americans were forced to choose. They could cede the night to the enemy, which would allow the Haji to plant IEDs, move supplies, and intimidate the locals. Or they could conduct patrols. Unpredictable patrols that left the base at all hours, followed random routes, and were targeted to different objectives. One element was predictable, however, and that was the choice of vehicles used for nighttime operations. In spite of their efforts to change things up, the Americans knew they'd come under fire occasionally and be targeted with IEDs. So the mine-resistant ambush-protected trucks called MRAPs were the best way to go. The boxy trucks came in a variety of configurations. The one looming over them had a 50 mounted up top and firing ports along both sides. And to give the patrol even more firepower, Ops was sending a striker vehicle along. The MRAP's engine was running and a squad of soldiers was seated inside. A staff sergeant nodded to Falco.
"Good evening, sir. Where's the rest of your team?"
"They're goofing off," Falco replied. "It's just the two of us tonight. We need to stop at the gate on the way out."
"Roger that," the sergeant said. "Okay, Morris, you heard the major, let's roll."
There was a slight jerk as Morris put his foot down. A series of turns took them to Hollywood Boulevard, which led to the gate. An MP stepped up to the driver's side window as the MRAP came to a halt.
"Tell him that Mr. Mahamadi is aboard," Falco instructed.
The driver relayed the message and the MP disappeared. When the soldier returned, he was carrying an AK-47 and a canvas bag full of spare magazines. Mahamadi accepted both without comment.
"Don't load your weapon," the sergeant cautioned. "Not until you're clear of the vehicle."
The gate swung open. Maybe Mahamadi's feelings were hurt, and maybe they weren't. But the Afghan understood. In the wake of various green-on-blue shootings, Afghan nationals weren't permitted to carry weapons inside the wire, and the sergeant was determined to protect his soldiers. Falco stood next to the driver.
"You know where the drop point is?"
Morris nodded.
"Yes, sir. It was in the briefing."
"Good. Make it quick," Falco said.
"I will," Morris promised. Both of them knew that what appeared to be empty farmland frequently wasn't, and if the men were spotted, that could be disastrous. The MRAP's armor was superior to the Striker's, so it took the lead. The route had been allowed to cool for a week. The road passed between two fields of wheat, through the small village of Hadit, and across a swiftly flowing river. There was a bridge, but that was a natural place to place an IED, so Morris drove the MRAP through the waist-high water and onto the opposite bank. After 15 minutes of uneventful driving, the vehicles arrived at an intersection where the MRAP paused. That, too, was a likely place for an IED, and Falco waited for an explosion that didn't come.
"This is where we get out," Mahamadi informed him.
Falco thanked Morris prior to exiting the vehicle into the cool night air. Mahamadi followed him. The first thing the Afghan did was to load his AK-47. Falco was ready to fire if the AK's barrel began to swing his way. It didn't. The assault rifle had a sling which Mahamadi hooked over his shoulder.
"I will lead the way," he announced.
And that was logical,
since the Afghan was what the Brits would call a farmer Barma, meaning a local guide. And if there were traps ahead, Mohammadi would trigger them. Falco had to watch his six, however. That meant glancing back over his shoulder at regular intervals. Mohammadi led Falco across the road to a path that wound up along the side of a hill. Falco could see quite well thanks to his night vision gear, but there wasn't much to look at. Their surroundings consisted of boulders, scrub, and the occasional wind-twisted tree. There were stars, however, thousands of them. They twinkled and were a good source of ambient light. Falco was in good shape, so the climb was easy at first. But he was breathing heavily by the time they arrived at the village of Imbal. Mohammadi was unfazed. "This is where the wedding will take place," he whispered. "We will be up there," Mohammadi pointed up into the darkness. "You will see everything." Falco knew that, and the fact that his surroundings matched his expectations was a source of comfort. The egress route was on the opposite side of the hill. If everything went well, the Taliban fighters would be disorganized during the minutes immediately after Hashemi's death. That would help them escape. But if things went badly, he'd call for help. "Okay," Falco said. "Lead the way." The second trail was less worn than the first, and likely to be the province of goats and the boys who were in charge of them. It zigzagged back and forth for a while, circled around a pinnacle of rock, and petered out. "This is it," Mohammadi said, as he came to a halt. "Wait until the sun rises. Everything will be visible, including the road into Imbal." Falco nodded. "That's good, Joan. But people will see us."
"Not so," Mohammadi replied.
"Come, I will show you." After turning their night vision gear off and their headlamps on, the men entered a jumble of rocks. Falco followed Mohammadi through a narrow passageway and into the cave beyond. It was large enough to stand in, but far from secret, judging from the litter that covered the ground.
"Look," Mohammadi said proudly. "Water. I brought it here 2 days ago."
Falco looked, and sure enough, 2 1-gallon containers of water were hidden behind some rocks.
"Well done,"
Falco said, even though the previous visit was a source of concern. Had the Taliban been tracking Mahamadi's movements? Bad things would happen if so. "All right," Falco said. "Let's take 5. Mohammadi hadn't seen a jet boil before and was amazed by the speed with which the device could boil water. The Afghan made green tea, while Falco poured his half of the hot liquid over 2 packs of instant coffee. Then, with a power bar each, they settled in. Mohammadi told a story about staying in the cave as a child, while Falco listened to a report from a drone operator via the earbuds hooked into the 117G. There were no heat signatures in the immediate area, other than those generated by goats, and Falco let Mohammadi's words wash over him. When the sun rose, the men went outside to greet it. The sound was faint, but Falco could hear the pre-dawn call to prayer, or Salat al-Fajr, being broadcast from the village mosque, and knew the faithful were up and about. The men lay flat on their stomachs as the sun continued to rise behind them, and they glassed the village with binoculars. Falco was using a GPS-enabled portable rangefinder, PLRF, which provided coordinates for whatever he looked at. "Start on the left," Falco said, "and give me a tour. I want to know what each building is used for." Falco took notes as Mohammadi ran through the list. There was a shoe store, a barber shop, a fabric store, what had once been a movie theater, an outdoor restaurant, the wedding hall where the nuptials would take place, a hole-in-the-wall pharmacy, a school, and the mosque. Once the review was complete, Falco read his notes back to Mohammadi and confirmed that they were correct before uploading them via the tablet and an uplink. Falco was putting the computer away when Mohammadi spoke.
"2 men left the village and are climbing the hill. They're hidden now, but they will reappear soon."
Falco swore. "Are they armed?"
"Yes," Mohammadi replied. "Most men are."
That was true, and Falco felt sure they were Taliban. Why? Because if the hill was a natural vantage point for him, it was a natural vantage point for the Haji, too, and Hashemi was coming to town. Falco didn't give any thought to the possibility of an enemy overlook and felt stupid. The realization was humbling, but thanks to Mohammadi, there was time to prepare.
"Okay," Falco said.
"We'll kill them. Here's what I want you to do."
The better part of 20 minutes passed before the Taliban fighters arrived on the hilltop. Mahamadi was there to greet them. He was seated on a boulder drinking tea, a scene so innocent that the Haji didn't bother to unsling their weapons.
Jawan, one of them said in Pashto. What are you doing here? Shouldn't you be kissing some crusader's ass?
Falco was hiding in the jumble of rocks. The special issue 22 caliber was in his hand. So long as he did the job correctly, the Mujahideen didn't have a chance. Nor did the murderous bastards deserve one. Falco stepped out into the open, took aim, and shot a man in the back of the head. The 22 caliber made no more than a clicking sound as two bullets struck home. The second Haji was turning as the body fell and fumbling with his assault rifle. Falco shot him in the temple, twice. The man collapsed. Mahamadi went over to spit on the body.
I know them. These pigs eat from Hashemi's trough.
The second one has a radio, Falco observed. I want you to monitor it. And if someone calls, try to make it sound as if the lookouts are trying to respond but can't, Falco told him. Press a lot of buttons, but don't say anything. That's the best we can do. Most Afghan weddings began at roughly 1700 hours, and according to Mahamadi, this one would as well. That meant hours would pass before they could expect to see Hashemi. But what if he arrived early?
Assumptions are bad, Falco reminded himself, and vigilance is good.
So they took turns scanning the village square as the minutes crept by. There was some traffic on the Mujahideen radio, but no calls to the dead men, for which Falco was grateful. People came and went. A dog dozed in the sun. An elaborately decorated bus arrived, and five well-dressed passengers got off. They were carrying packages. Wedding guests? Probably. Boys were dismissed from school. Men entered the mosque for Asr, or the mid-afternoon prayer, and filtered out half an hour later. Then Falco heard it. A laconic message from a drone pilot who was sitting in front of a screen at Creech Air Force Base back in the US of A. We have five vehicles approaching Imbal from the west. Falco turned his binoculars to the road and was watching when the first vehicle appeared. It was an ancient Mercedes convertible. The top was down and a passenger could be seen in back. As Falco focused his glasses, he expected to see Hashemi. But the man in the Mercedes wasn't Hashemi. Falco didn't think so anyway, although the photos he'd seen were 2 years old.
Jawan, the man in the Mercedes, is that Hashemi?
Mahamadi looked and shook his head.
No, I've never seen him before.
Falco's mind was racing. What the hell was going on? Had Hashemi been replaced? Was the man in the car an envoy? Sent to represent the Taliban leader? Or was Hashemi playing games? To fool him? No, Hashemi didn't know about the trap. He was worried about predator drones and trying to confuse the people who flew them.
There he is! Mahamadi exclaimed, right there, standing in front of the wedding hall.
Falco shifted the rangefinder to the left, and sure enough, Hashemi was there surrounded by a half dozen fighters. Hashemi had arrived under the cover of darkness, and now he was making his presence known, not just anywhere, but at the center of Imbal, where a UAV operator would be hesitant to strike without a positive ID, and faces were difficult to make out from drone footage. So Hashemi believed himself to be safe. But was he? Falco figured that a carefully targeted missile could take the bastard and his entourage out while causing minimal damage to the village. The first step was to pass the targeting data to a pilot who was circling an area north of them. Falco felt a terrible tightness in his chest as he eyed the prospective blast area. Maybe the locals were afraid of the Taliban, or maybe it was happenstance, but the area around Hashemi was clear. Falco made the call.
Bring it.
Falco heard a bump of static followed by a laconic, in from the north.
Cleared hot.
The fighter entered a steep dive. A missile flashed off the plane's starboard wing. The pilot said, rifle, which indicated that he had released a missile rather than a bomb. Falco was waiting for the explosion when the door to the wedding hall opened and three burqa-clad women emerged. Falco yelled,
shift cold! Shift cold!
Hoping there was enough time for the pilot to direct the missile away. But it was too late. Falco watched in horror as the missile struck. There was a flash of light, a loud boom, and an upwelling of smoke. Mahamadi shouted,
Praise be to Allah!
There was nothing Falco could do except deliver a formulaic report. Good bombs, target down, mission successful. Even though it hadn't been entirely successful. The target was dead, all right, but so were three civilians, and that sucked. Falco stood and shouldered his pack. It's time to go. Lead the way. Falco could have led the way himself, but it made sense to put Mohammadi out front, rather than expose his back to the Afghan. The second trail was steep and treacherous in spots. Falco did his best to avoid thinking about the women, including who they were, why they'd been there, or anything else about them. His job was to focus on the exfil, check the back trail, call for a helo, run and run some more. And when Falco fell, he got back up. His ankle hurt. He ran anyway. The process was automatic and seemed to take care of itself. A Black Hawk helicopter swooped in to pick the men up as they arrived on the flat ground at the foot of the slope. The rotors blew dust in every direction, and a door gunner was eyeing the hill behind them. Mohammadi boarded first, followed by Falco. The JTAC fell into his seat and stared at the floor as the helo lifted off. It took 15 minutes to reach forward operating base Hope. Colonel Campa was waiting next to the pad as Falco dropped to the ground and winced. The ankle hurt like hell. The men shook hands. They had to yell in order to be heard over the racket.
Congratulations, Campo said. You nailed the bastard.
I also killed some civilians, Falco replied darkly.
There was some collateral damage, Campo admitted, but it couldn't be helped. The missile was on the way when the civilians entered the kill zone, and that, Major, is what you will tell the investigation board.
I'm being grounded.
It's SOP, you know that.
Yeah, Falco agreed. I know that.
Don't worry, Campo assured him. You'll be fine. Hell, I'm putting you in for a medal. Come on, there's a bottle of Jack on my desk. We're going to have a drink.
Thank you, sir. I'll meet you there. Falco turned, saw that Mohammadi was standing by himself, and went over to shake hands.
Thank you, Juwan. You're a brave man, and a good brother. We're pulling out. You know that. Go away from here, far, far away.
I will, Mohammadi replied. As for the women, do not worry. They are in Jannah, paradise, with my sister.
After parting ways with Mohammadi, Falco crossed the camp to the headquarters bunker and followed the ramp down to the Merc. If there had been a worse day in his life, he couldn't remember it. People stared, radios murmured, and the Air Force swallowed him up. Chapter 3. Eielson Air Force Base, Alaska, USA. Eielson Air Force Base was located 26 miles southeast of Fairbanks, Alaska. The primary purpose of the base was to host an Allied Forces training exercise called Red Flag Alaska. And because of the war, such efforts were even more important than they'd been before. So when Red Flag pilot Kathy Parker requested permission to go home for her grandmother's funeral, she'd been granted 3 days rather than the 5 she'd requested. And as the SUV entered the base, Parker felt lucky to get that. After thanking a fellow Red Flag pilot for the ride, Parker made her way into the terminal and went to check in.
Yes, ma'am, the sergeant behind the desk said as he eyed her paperwork. Your Mighty Mouse will board in 15 minutes. Have a nice flight.
Parker knew there wouldn't be any amenities on the plane, so she went to get a grande coffee and some candy bars. She was eating one of them and sipping coffee when a captain sidled up to her. He was in uniform and wearing a judge advocate badge. That meant he was a lawyer.
Here we go, Parker thought. Maybe I should put the ring back on.
Hi, the JAG said brightly. Are you on the flight to Fairchild?
Yes, Parker replied. I am.
Work or pleasure?
Neither one. My grandmother died. I'm going to her funeral.
Parker knew some men would hit on her anyway. Fortunately, the lawyer wasn't one of them.
I'm sorry to hear about your loss, he said.
And after chatting about how difficult such times were, he drifted away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.